For me, Okama Falade, and I welcome you all to Reimagine. So this event is the first in a series of centered on perspectives from the lens of language and culture. As we all know, this year will go down in history as the year of the pandemic. Our world has gone through a process of adapting to the spread of the COVID-19 virus, and most of us have had to redefine how we communicate and interact with each other. There is no denying that this year has presented many challenges, but those challenges have also forced an emergence of many opportunities. Opportunities for us to grow, learn, explore, break down barriers, and build alliances to emerge stronger than ever. This event is one of those opportunities. Today, we're going to dig deep into the reality of living in America and explore how to chart a path for the future. We will have tough conversations about race in our nation as we look for meaningful and lasting solutions. There's a lot to learn and unlearn. These conversations are going to be challenging, even uncomfortable, but they're important because this time we get to reimagine America together. I sincerely hope we can individually begin to chart new paths that reflect our collective notions of being human. So before I turn over to our moderator, I would like to invite Adeolu Okulaja, who is a cultural connector and bridge builder with Nigerian roots. He connects across different cultures, languages, and areas of work to support people to learn from each other and recognize the power of their culture and language. And he also works as an architect in Lagos, Nigeria. So Adeolu, I pass it over to you.
Thanks a lot, Fumi. It's a delight to be with everybody this morning. I am Adeolu Okulaja, as Fumi has mentioned. And today, I want to let you know that our conversations will explore our cultural level conflicts as a generation. Here, we will treat culture as a phenomenon. We will elaborate on the significance of culture, intercultural communication, conflict resolution, cultural dialogue, and cultural conversations in context. Furthermore, we will examine the functioning of culture of dialogue, find ways for creative mediation, and restore the practical dimensions of multiculturalism. At this point, since we are quite a few in number, but I would hand over to Pastor Yone Oswald, and he would do the introductions for the speakers. Thank you very much. You're welcome to Reimagine.
All right. Well, I know we did some introductions already, but it's really good to be able to have this group of people together. And first of all, I appreciate the speakers who have taken some of their time today to be part of this conversation. Today we have with us Michael Oshindoro, who is a PhD student, like you mentioned, in the African Cultural Studies Department at the University of Wisconsin. Michael has training in linguistics, language, pedagogy, and literature. He studies how language and culture interact to inform the ways in which identities are formed. As a Fulbright scholar, Michael taught Yoruba language and culture in an American university and served as a cultural ambassador of his home country, Nigeria. He has worked on the politics of language, critical race theory, gender relations in Africa. At the moment, studying how visual art forms are representing African cultural realities and creating new imaginaries. Welcome, Michael.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Dr. Okulaja was born and raised in Lagos State, Nigeria. She moved to the United States in 1994 after graduating from medical school and completed a residency internal medicine pediatrics in 2001 before moving to the to pioneer all pediatric clinic in Menomonee, Wisconsin. She currently runs her own practice, the doctor's house, where she focuses on the health of the whole person. Along with being a physician, she's also an author, poet, singer, and is about to release a jazz single titled I Am She. A woman of faith, she truly believes that we have the power to accomplish all that God has called us to accomplish this side of eternity and beyond.
Okay, Vicky.
Elijah. Wendy, who is also here with us, is one of us. Is an accomplished immigration and nationality attorney who has provided services for over 39 years. She serves as counsel to the Mexican consulate in Philadelphia. Additionally, she's the current chair of the Philadelphia Bar Association's Immigration Committee. She's also co-chair of Pennsylvania's Bar Association's Immigration Committee, and she's a board member of PIAS Pennsylvania. In 2015 and 2016, respectively, Super Lawyer was recognized as one of the top women lawyers in Pennsylvania. Thank you. Our last speaker, is also an attorney, a public speaker, and a cultural artist. She's the founder of the multiple award-winning center, Paraculture. Paraculture is an educational and recreational organization set up in 2003 to promote the richness and diversity of Nigerian languages, arts, and culture. She's also the founder of BAP Productions and has directed award-winning music that have traveled around the world, such as Carol, Waka the Musical, Fela and the Kalakuta Queens, and Moremi the Musical. The producer of the multiple award-winning movie 93 Days, and also directed the blockbuster movie The Bling Negotiators in 2000. Nations in Germany and Namibia will be enjoying one of the conversations in today's afternoon. With that, I want to turn it over again to Adeolu, who will provide again some additional context on our conversation.
Thank you very much. It's nice to see that we have most of our speakers on board. Unfortunately, I've been trying to reach our last speaker, but she will be here shortly. Basically, we are looking at cultural integration and intercultural dialogue. We are trying to reimagine anew, in the sense that we're looking at our context as individuals in the country of America. And we're coming together as different ethnicities in a particular context. We would definitely reflect on this year as being one that has been a bit difficult, in the sense that we've had so many things to deal with. And we have found that a lot of things have been polarized politically, health-wise, and even communication within families have been very difficult. To ask the question, are we still able to connect, goes without saying. We hope that our distinguished panel of speakers will be able to dissect the cogent issues at hand And in doing so, we might try and chart a pathway to see how we can get out of the polarization that we are currently experiencing. So I welcome everybody to a free discussion, open discussion, and engaging discussion. And we hope that we will all learn and move forward from this position. Thank you, and have a wonderful discussion. I hand over to Pastor Yone, who would now take the reins of the event. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for those who have joined the queue. If you have the mic, I encourage you to mute if you're not speaking, so that way we minimize background noise. Again, I'll encourage you, if you're not speaking, if you don't mind putting your mic mute. All right. Okay. Well, part of the conversation we're going to have today is going to be based off of a video clip that we're going to. And just to give some context, some background, what we're going to see is not a pre-recorded event. It actually was something that happened somewhat spontaneous. And the scene that we're going to look at, which is going to form some of the conversations we're going to have, I would encourage you to look for these states of cultural interactions. And as you observe the scene on the video, I want you to probably think to yourselves, like, what might be going on here as you watch the video. Our speakers are now going to talk about what their understanding and their sense and their feelings were from the video after we've showed it. So at this point, I'll just share this video with all of us, which we're looking at courtesy of Portland State University.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting. Still there, oh, say that.
All right, again, thank you again for observing this video. And I'm sure that you have, I'm hoping that you had some thoughts as you were watching this scene play out. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to our speakers, and I'll ask them in turn to share maybe for about 5 to 10 minutes on their thoughts of what they saw in the video in the context of the conversation we're having today on cultural integration and intercultural dialogue. And I'd like to start with Wendy.
Well, I know the background because I fast-forwarded thanks to what Adeolu told me, and I know how this came about. So I'm going to pretend that I don't know and just tell you my gut reaction to it. Random woman practicing in an area, in a school, in a public place with a beautiful voice. Random other person with an equally beautiful voice comes. Each separately has a beautiful voice. Each looks very, very different if we look at divided America today. But when you put two beautiful voices together, it becomes even more beautiful than each one separately. And when I look at that, I see music as a commonality, as a healing. That's my initial reaction to that, and the fact that if we can get along and sing together because we each have a love for it, why can't we get along with everybody else? And how do we use music? It's one of the million choosing that commonality so that life can be better for everybody and the hate goes away. That's my reaction.
Thank you, Wendy. And I know that I was supposed to be showing another scene before I
It's pretty silent on campus at Portland State, just like it has been here for about 3 months.
I majored in jazz, so I'm a music major, and that was kind of my specialty.
A disappointing finish is how you could describe medicine. In Hallberg's senior year at PSU, but she speaks about the good stuff.
I loved my time at PSU. I think what made it amazing was all of the opportunities that I got through singing with the chamber choir.
A gifted vocalist, Madison went back to campus in late May to perform a song for the class of 2020.
I love all music. I have a really wide appreciation, and I want to always be aware of where the music that I like comes from.
For this year's virtual commencement, the school asked her to record this video of her singing the national anthem.
We're so gallantly streaming.
Her voice echoing between the trees, making way for an unexpected moment.
Just as an African-American, well, male, walking the park blocks, I didn't see a white individual or a woman or these things. I just saw what felt like music.
Emmanuel Henri lives near the park blocks. He felt the need to go outside and get some air. What hit him?
So as I was walking by, I kind of passed Madison as she was singing. I didn't know who she was at the time or what they were filming for.
And the rockets were good.
past, and I was like, you know what? Let's just back up. Let's just do it. Just be brave. Just ask if she wants to sing together.
Henri is a professional opera singer and has performed all over the world. He understands how versatile a voice can be.
It heals, and it suddenly connects.
Like, as a white person, it felt so right singing it with you more than by myself.
Two artists from different backgrounds joining voices.
It is the same instrument with the same amount of love, joy, healing, and peace that comes along with that. And the way that we use that gift is empowering, and it washes over others. It changes their lives exponentially.
It's a song with a message that sounds so different to so many. But these days, for these two, it's not about what you hear. It's how you listen.
And listen to what they're doing with their voice and adapt to that. And don't try to out-sing the person next to you, but listen to them.
And that applies to all of life. Make sure you listen louder than you speak.
Whether you've worked hard on your voice, like Henri and Madison, or you're just discovering it, whatever you do, don't keep it silent.
When we kind of let our voices pour out, stop us.
And the home of the
Thank you. Over to you, Dr. Barrow.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I hope you'll tell me when my time's up, because like I said, I'm a bit of a talker. And that's what I bring to the table. I bring words to the table. And I'm just gonna concentrate on what we just watched. I saw this video beforehand, just as Wendy had done. I think it was just to kind of give me an idea and sensitize me to what you want us to talk about today. And I think it's beautiful. I'd like to say that what is happening in the US right now, and I know that you talked about the US, but I think that we need to look at this in a more global with a more global view, in that this is starting in America, but it actually involves the whole world. You know, I started watching during the time of this pandemic, there's nowhere to go, so Netflix is my new friend. And I started watching a lot of foreign movies with subtitles. And I've watched Indian movies, I've watched Nigerian movies. My latest one was a Spanish soap opera, and I watched all seasons. And when I discover something, I tell everybody about it. You know, everybody has to know. But what I'm learning is that what we're dealing with is not unique in terms of race in the United States. We deal with it in different parts of the world in terms of caste. You know, caste are something big in even in countries that are the same color, the same hue. The different shades of the hue is important. You know, I got to learn about the paper bag test amongst even the African Americans here in the United States. If you're darker than a paper bag, if you're lighter than a paper bag, you know, so different prejudices. And this is something I did not grow up with. I didn't grow up with it, even though British educated in Nigeria, which is one of the reasons why I'm actually in the United States. It took me years of psychoanalysis and going into myself to say, why did I move away from Nigeria? I was comfortable. I have a big family. By the time I had graduated from medical school, we went through a rough patch, but by the time I went through medical and graduated, I really didn't have any reason to leave my country. There was no reason, all right, Adeolu? He's my brother, so he knows. But this was just something that kept coming into my mind. And the school I went to, I grew up on Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Paddington Bear, and you know, Mr. Willy Wonka and all that stuff. I didn't grow up with the stuff that I had in my own culture. So when I graduated and came out of university, and this I'll segue into what thrust into this world that I knew nothing about, bus because and all that stuff. He's telling me I have to. Have I been speaking for 3 minutes or 5 minutes? Okay. Well, just looking at the video, what there's some points that occurred to me is that there was a willingness. You know, first of all, there's a comfort with the environment, and a lot of what is going on with the things that are in America now, as I attempted to illustrate with my own background, is the fact that a lot of us don't feel comfortable where we are. And I hope that we will speak no holds barred. And I love what Wendy said about music uniting us and being the unifier in this situation. And I think that what's going on, this collusion of hate and actually, it's a good, people are going to tell me what about. It's a good thing, because if we don't identify the problem in its raw sense, we can't talk about a solution. If everything's hidden under pleasant smiles and, you know, not interacting, each person keeping to their own track, we can never, ever, you know, how do you say, cross this chasm. So in I saw in that video, this was something of a beautiful thing in seeing that, okay, this problem is bad, but may actually be a good thing. And these people that are not comfortable with themselves, they could never be comfortable with each other. So being comfortable in our own skin is very important. Learning that we have to be comfortable in our environment is very important. This was a recipe for disaster. This is an African-American man with a white female. It could have easily turned out differently. But because these people were comfortable and they had education, not only formal education, but emotional education, emotional intelligence, to realize that this person that's coming towards me, I have nothing to fear from them because their soul looks like my soul, you know? And then the other thing is that what I noticed was that this gentleman did not just invade her space, did not just come in and, hey, I'm going to sing with you. He asked for permission. He said, can I sing with you? I love what I'm hearing. Can I be a part of it? There's a form of invitation in that interaction that makes it beautiful, that makes it like, okay, I want to be a part of your world. Will you let me in? And she said, fine, I'll let you in. And then the other thing that one connection point was music. And another connection point that was actually not seen was the fact that they were both educated musicians. They didn't know that from the beginning. He was an trained opera singer. She's a jazz student. So I feel that, you know, in about the things that, and just listen to the soul of that person. And when we listen to the soul of that person, we find out that, you know what, you know, the education he got in some subliminal, weird and wonderful way connected with the education that she had with a connection point, and they were able to create something beautiful. And she said something there, and I'm going to finish in 2 seconds. They didn't overpower each other. You could see that the African-American way of singing is totally different. I could see it because I'm a singer. You know, he's doing his riffs and his raps and she's singing pretty steady, but he's not attempting to overcome her. And she's giving him room to be more creative in his own way. And because she's the owner of the room. So it was just beautiful to see that in the last two things. The willingness to adapt and to blend, adaptation, blending. That comes from a place of comfort, a place of seeing people not only physically, but allowing our souls to connect.
Thank you for sharing that. Thank you so much. And Michael, I'll turn it over to you now to share some of your thoughts on the video.
Yeah, I would just like to echo the first two speakers, because those are very insightful observations and reading of that. One thing that struck me though is among all of these things that they share together, they share the knowledge of the lyrics, the song that they're singing. So the fact that they are on the same page, that give them the launch pad to go into cultural conversations and linking, like the last speaker says. I think that one other very important thing to take away is how we might think of how, what could have happened if we not shared the same language, you know, what would have been the situation? And I think that the power of language comes in and how we can wait, like the last speaker, Ms. Dick Barrow says, that we need to wait, we need to clarify, we need to ask permission, we need to be sure of what we need to do in this situation. And it reminds me of what a particular situation. So there was this colonial person, Spaniard, and a Mexican. So, okay, was a greeting. Because they needed to communicate, they had interlocutors, translators. And one asked the other, are you the person that I think you are? In that person's culture, it is very off-putting to say, yes, I am. This person is powerful, but they tend to be reverent and say, oh, I am not. I am not. That person, through the translators, they took it to mean the exact opposite of, well, I am, but I am humble to tell you that I that is just such a big position that you're putting upon me. Meaning is lost in translation there. And I think that one thing that we might continue to think about in terms of intercultural relations is how well we can wait before we go on to melt, blend, and do all of that. Yeah.
Thank you, Michael, for sharing that. And that Perry and Wendy, I think those were all very insightful observations on the way that you have interpreted the interaction between these two singers. I like the fact that you highlight in the form of language, in this case it was music, highlights about permission, not in a forceful way, but in a subtle way, to engage in something that was common. I like the fact that we highlighted the both of them knew the song, which made it perhaps a little easier for them to engage and have a conversation about style. So engaging in a way that one style wasn't dominating the other style, right? There was the reference to how the African American sings a little different from how the Caucasian might sing, but as we listen to the song ourselves, good things that everyone has shared form a good we talked about reimagining. Reimagine what it would be like if we we can interact in this way more times than not. And what does that do with and intercultural dialogue? I want to spend a little bit of time now for a quick panel discussion, after which what we want to do is open it up to all the folks who are on the questions of you based on some of the things that you have shared. Okay, I do have maybe a couple of questions for each of you on the panel here, and I would appreciate your, you know, answering them, and in answering it, if it can be connected to the video, even better, because that's the bedrock of what we're having this dialogue around today. So the first question I have is for Dr. Okulaja. And the question is about code switching. And some of us understand. Can you hear me? Okay, I can hear you. You're mute, okay. But and I don't know if maybe some volumes have to be turned up, but I'm going to try to talk a little louder, but if you can't hear me, I apologize. So the question about code switching. So code switching is a way that people have used to adapt in their way of, in some cases, because that it is a reason that people lose identities to, and in the process of that code switching, my accommodate prejudices. So the question I have for you, Dr. Perro, is what do you agree or disagree with this idea that code switching can cause you to, you know, sort of lose your own identity, because in the attempt of code switching, you try to become somebody else. So to what extent do you agree or disagree with that thought?
I think that question is perfect for me, because in the line of my work, I see a lot of people. And I am one who believes in code switching. And the reason I believe in it, or I think it's a good thing, is exactly what we're doing today. I have code switched, believe it or not, because I am talking to all of you. And Wendy's on the line, Oswald is on the line, Michael's on the line, Bukola, Shay, Ngozi. So I have to look, in my opinion, where I can easily understand me and you can relate. I tell my patients that, you know, it's very funny. I can adapt a lot of accents. For example, now I can switch to my Nigerian accent, because if it were all Nigerian people that were on this call right now, this is the way I'll be speaking. But the way I'm speaking right now, Wendy will likely not be able to pick up everything saying. So, you know, but maybe Mandy can, because she has dealt with a lot of us over the years, you know, so, you know, say, you know, hello, good morning, that's brilliant. And I can do my southern accent and say, how you doing? Girl, you're not going to tell me that you did that today. You know, no, we are not doing that today. No. Merci, monsieur. Comment ça va? I can switch, not because I don't have an idea of who I am. I have a very strong idea of who I am. And I think that's the difference when you talk about code switching. You have to know the code for your own identity and be aware that other people may not be able to dial into that code, you know, yet. You know, they may grow into it. Like, for example, I have an African-American friend. She's from the South, and she tells me, Addie, that's just not right. When I start speaking my Southern accent, it's like, hi, Mama. What's up today? How you doing? She said, that's just not right, honey. You just don't sound right, you know? So what am I trying to do? I'm trying to find common ground with her. It doesn't take away from my identity, but she has learned how to eat hot pepper. Adeolu will remember the first time she ate hot pepper. We thought the world was going to come to an end. It was like, oh, oh, oh. But she learned because I gave her room to learn by first of all speaking in her language and then teaching her my language. And I'm not talking about physical languages right now. I'm talking about emotion and the way we interact. Like Nigerians, see, we just say, ah, let you, this is sweet thing with you. It doesn't have anything to do with whether you agree or not, because everybody feels that everybody has to be comfortable with what everybody brings to the scene. So if I'm with a Nigerian, what happens? Ah, let's sing together. The Lord of me, whether you know how to or not. And oh, you know. But when you when would you go and you say, I hear you singing and I read that song, it doesn't take away from me. It's me trying to build a bridge. Now, the other flip side of that though is that too much. Always movement from one side of the bridge. If there's only movement in one direction, the aim of code switching to me has been lost. Code switching is my way of helping you to be comfortable and to my way of speaking with. For example, I see Somali patients, who are Caucasian, white, complete Midwestern. But the way I speak is totally different. I had a Somali tell me, if you come, I won't see you. That's it. Not see you again. Finito. Don't. No, 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 no. Do you see what I'm trying to say? This is not me. This is not me, but I have to switch to bring them in for the, I have to speak their own language. If I spoke to my Midwestern patients like that, I would have no practice. I would have absolutely no practice. And I do it so well in some cases, and this is where I'm going to end, so you know where I stand now. I do it so well that, you know, my Southern accent, when I really get into my role, you really can't tell if I'm from Kentucky or not. Some person I said, you know, no, said, I introduced my friend to you. Oh, Dr. Okolaja, she's from Kentucky. And she actually thought I was really from Kentucky by way of Nigeria. Well, I'm from Kentucky by way of Nigeria. And she's like, oh, I heard you were from Kentucky. I said, no. This is just my way of interacting. And if we are in a multicultural environment, I go like this to work. This is not me trying to be somebody else, but I believe in building bridges. And once you know who I am, I begin to be able to interact with you in a form that if I had introduced you to, like just boom, when I first met you, you would have been not able to interact with me. I hope that answers the question in some way. I hope so.
Actually, you touched, yeah, you did very well. Thank you very much. So, here's the context of code switching, and you need a lot of value in it. Now, my next question is going to be for Michael, and not the same question with code switching, but from a context of language, culture, and resiliency, right? How does one's language and one's culture, or how can one's language and one's culture allow them to be resilient, even when they might be practicing code switching in the manner that Dr. Okolaja just described?
Thanks. In my linguistics, introductory linguistics class, they taught us that code mixing and code switching are those conversational strategies where you move from one language to another. In the case of code mixing, you are dealing with words. In the case of code switching, you are moving from phrase in your language to another phrase or sentence or idea in the other language. So I am Yoruba, and to one way we say you need to go to get to the bank is Mofede Bank. That is one way that the Nigerian would use that expression. They would not say Ile Ifowopamo. It is not because the word does not exist. It is just because they are much more familiar. It's much more natural to them now. The word natural is key now. Yoruba should be natural. And so when you mix it, you're diluting it. I think it is important for us to admit that what we call Yoruba itself, as or English itself, or French itself, or Portuguese itself, has undergone a number of changes. We will trace it synchronously or diachronously to understand that this language was in a totally different state many years ago. The way that language is shifting, if language could shift, we are bound to shift. We, the users of language, are bound to shift. As long as we are in contact with other people, we will always exercise and, you know, show these changes in ourselves. And so that dynamism is key, and it's very important to answering this question about resilience. One way that I understand, it's not my first exposure to the word, but I came to appreciate more during the COVID-19 pandemic, because people were talking about economic resilience, that in this time of COVID-19, on the ground, that in the face of this adversity, we should get ourselves going. To translate that into the context that we are speaking, I think sometimes when I am alone, I need to listen to something. I am down, I need to uplift myself. The music I listen to are the music that inner core. And most of my life.
And from what we had, there's first the first part of the things that Metabal answered to was the fact she is able to use this context and Michael suggested that doing that into pathway, but it is because we have the space that we find those into consideration, and knowing that we live in our society, what are some of the things that you, Wendy, think have to be in place to ensure that all ethnicities are equitably represented in a place like the United States?
Well, that's a lot of a question based upon a lot of really good information. I want to double back a little bit to talk about the first question about asking permission to be let in I think that's a foundational basis of this. And when I was in law school, my second year of law school, I had a law school professor who was brilliant. And he said, it is customary of barbarians to fear strangers. And that stayed with me. Because it is customary of cultures, people, strangers, and strangers mean different. And I was never brought up to be afraid of differences. I was brought up to think they were interesting and to embrace them and that they were enriching. And I've raised my children that way. And I think about the fact that both of my children are dogs, and I don't have grandchildren, but I have grand dogs. And one of the things that they've taught me, when I go to dogs, they'll run away because they're afraid of me. But if I hold out my hand and I let them sniff, and I say basically by doing that, I am inviting you to invite me in, and you have nothing to fear from me because I'm not going to hurt you. I just want to love you. Then sometimes it works. There's a rescue dog in my condo complex, and this dog is named Stevie. She's a tiny little thing. She would let no one near her. A year and a half later, the minute she sees me, she's jumping all over me because she's not afraid of me. And even going as far as the video that we watched, it was that, may I enter your world? You have nothing to fear from me, that allowed that beautiful musical conversation to take place. So when we talk about what elements we introduce in and code switching, I'll give you a couple of examples just this past week. I code switch all the time, just like you do, Ade. I'm constantly doing it. I have clients from all over the world, but I ask them all the time to teach me who they are. But I understand it really doesn't make a difference what they look like on the surface, what language they speak, religion with or no religion at all, that everybody's really essentially the same. And you need to be able to dig down. Everybody wants to be loved, respected, be surrounded, have food on their table, not live in fear. But you have to open up to people, and you have to listen. I've heard that word a lot this morning. You have to listen to other people, and other people communicate very differently. Just like Ade, you were talking about your Somali client, how you speak to that Somali client. When I speak to each client from every country, I have to look at their level of education. I have to look at their cultural background, and I have to look at their socioeconomic background. Because if I say something to a much wealthier Mexican versus a non-educated, poorer Mexican, I'm going to get very different results. So I have to understand where they come from and whether culturally they're going to feel that it's okay to ask me questions to contradict me. Because if you come from a lower economic, lack of educated background, you're not going to be able to ask questions because you're told a professional, whether it's a doctor or a lawyer, is really somebody you should look up to, but not somebody who's your equal. And we should all be equals. If you're not an equal with the person that you're working with, dealing with, communicating with, how can you even begin to understand? I had a Korean professor recently, and she's this tiny little thing. She's only 30. And she's maybe 32, and she brought her car into the shop. And there's a reason for this. I'm a lawyer. I always digress, but there is a moral at the end of this story. And she brought her car in, and she had a couple of accidents, and she brought it into a place by herself, And she said, "What I told them, I just wanted them to go ahead and give me an estimate." And then they called me and they told me it was done and I owed them the money and they didn't do what I wanted. So what do I do? "They're doing this to me," she told me, "because I am young, female, and Asian." And she's probably right. So what did I do? I code switched to remember when I was a young female situation, which was a car dealership or something, and I understood. The way you're going in, those racial, cultural, educational issues that was getting her not able to work with this car dealership and get the car back, it was her attitude. And the attitude was that she was waiting for somebody to do something terrible to them, her, because of who she was and her past experiences. So she came off as nasty, which she unfortunately often does, and she didn't get anything from that. So how do you introduce elements? What do you do to be invited in? You listen, you try to figure out, where is the other person coming from? What is their background? Why are they reacting this way? All of us see anger. And when I look at the world, I cry a lot of times. And Michael, I do what you do.
Understand the kind of baggage that you are dealing with.
Pardon?
I think someone was speaking over you. I'm going to mute everybody now.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Okay, so I do, Michael, what you do. There are some times that I just say, how do we fight our inability to understand each other because we see only differences and we don't see the core of our commonality? And I'll turn to music. I have different generational music. I don't listen to Euro music, but I do listen to a lot of protest music, like the Peter, Paul, and Mary and the Joni Mitchell and things like that. But I also listen to Rise Up or even things like The Prayer with Celine Dion and Andrea Bocelli, just things, and I'll just put my head down and I'll say, I can't do this anymore. How can I fight? And then I try to bring the strength back in, because if all of us on this call understand and don't do anything to change minds, nothing's going to get better. And I really think, and then I'll be quiet because I probably outused my time allotted to me. But I think creating one-on-one friendships can make a huge difference, even though it's only one person at a time, having us understand each other's, where we're coming. And he doesn't like what I do because I'm an immigration attorney and he's anti-immigrant. But he's a nice person and I don't understand his lack of understanding is good for this country. His daughter became very, very ill and I liked him. So I just called him to see how his daughter was doing. And he said to me something very strange. He said, "You know, thank you. I realized that you're a nice person and I now have a different way of looking at what you do for a living." And my purpose in calling him, he was in pain because he has a sick child. I'm a mother, I understand that. So without knowing, I built commonality. And even we were talking the other day that when at holidays, we're talking about Thanksgiving now. And if it weren't for COVID, we'd have lots of people at our Thanksgiving dinner. And I know, because I've been a foreigner, I've lived in another country. I lived in Spain where my most important words were, where's the bathroom? I had learned very quickly how to survive in a different culture. And when you're not invited, when you're not included in the fabric of the area that you're living, you feel like an outsider. So if you have an American friend, or if you're Nigerian and you have an American friend in your home country or wherever you are, or you just build community where people can eat a turkey, hopefully next year with a vaccine and vitamin D. Next year, we sit around and through food, through music, we see that we're really the same. And it really all comes down to one person at a time finding something that you enjoy together. And that's how you change hatred. If you can get through the crack. That's my thought. All right, I shall mute myself.
Thanks, Wendy. Well, so thank you all three for answering some of these questions that we started. And obviously, there's so many questions that can come out of what we've started talking. And if we're going to take all of them, it would be like, we could spend quite a while together. Nonetheless, we would like to hear from the audience here and see what some of their questions they might have. And if you do have a question that you want to ask of the panelists, please feel free to type into the chat. I do have one here that, well, it's actually a comment that I'll read out, and I would ask all of you to respond to it if you like, or just one person to respond to it. And the comment is to everyone, and so you all can read it, but I'll read it out anyways. It says, it seems like most of those who engage in code switching in terms of demographics are people of color. In fact, I noticed that many of my white counterparts are not even understanding of what code switching is. I think code switching is driven less by socioeconomic or by racial or place of origin background. And in general, code switching is normally directed more toward dominant culture. The thought is, from this individual, is that's just the reality, even if we don't care to recognize it because it's uncomfortable. Michael, Adipero, Wendy, any of you want to respond to that comment?
I'd like to respond, and I do agree. Kumo asked, and it's because I was looking on the chat, that's how I know that it's her question. And in some ways it's true, and in others it's not. Because there are some white people that I don't code switch with. It depends on the comfort zone. I remember I had an interaction with one of the gentlemen who turned out to be one of my best patients ever in Wisconsin. And this is me. I graduated from resident Philadelphia. And by the way, Wendy and I go really, 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 really way back. We go back to 1995. She followed me, or I followed her, I chased after her on my journey to citizenship. And I'm one of those people that did it the right way, you know, went through the whole thing. And it took me 10 years. The end of it, because of who Wendy is, and she understood the nuances of a foreigner in this country. My being able to stay in this country rather than being asked to go back and then back again was entirely due to Wendy. She was like, Addie, hold on, I will never forget. She said, you go on vacations a lot and this is gonna work for you in this situation. You need 3 weeks to have this stuff come through. I don't know if she remembers, but I remember, like they say in Africa, it's not the person who poops that remembers, it's the person who scoops it up and takes care of the problem. But she said, you need vacation for 50 out of this cohort extension based on those 55 days. And I filed for an H1B in this country legally while my papers were being, set up or whatever it was. But if she didn't understand me, if she didn't put herself in my place, it'll be like, yeah, she paid me my money. That's it. Whatever. you need to go back to Nigeria and come back. But she was heavily invested in helping me to to accomplish my purpose. And that has to do with wanting to. Now we're talking about code switching. I just put that in as an aside. I was in Wisconsin. I came from Philadelphia, and I'm in Menominee, Wisconsin. You are in Madison, right, Michael? Right, you're in Madison? It's a totally different world. You can't even find Menominee on the map. And so I go to this clinic on the first day, you know, and I have to work in Eau Claire before I moved to Menominee. And I had all sorts happen to me. I had a gentleman take a look at me and just run out of the clinic and happened to meet another physician on the in the hallway and said, you know, this is why I'm coming in. I have a rash here. Is this okay? Gone. I go into the room. I'm looking for my patient. My patient is nowhere to be found. And, you know, I had people who were absolutely phenomenal work with me. I remember my first nurse and, you know, people would come to them and ask about me and say, the new doctor, I hear she's, you know, trying to be politically correct. I hear, she's a white. She said, yeah. I'm sorry. I looked at something and my books on something. I hear she's female. Yeah. She's female. And then, no. I hear she's really good. Yeah. She's really good. You know, I hear she's, oh yeah, she's the best dog. She to engage these people. In seeing those people, I would walk in. I had no code for switching to them. I was totally African, totally who I was, because I knew that trying to engage them, they didn't have a door open for me. So there was no bridge to cross. So in that situation, it wasn't going to do any good. There was nothing good going to come out of it anyways. Now, fast forward to another patient that I saw when I actually started my patient. I love telling this story. I walked into the room, me and my flamboyant self, even though I'm black and I'm female, I don't look like a doctor. I have the brains of a doctor, but I don't look like a doctor. And I walk in and I see his face change. And this is the way I approach it. I said, sir, you look uncomfortable. And he said, yes, I am. He's one of the people I just have loved in my career. He said, I am. I said, well, there's nothing you can do about it now. You're here. Do you want to think about it? And he told me, yes, I'd like to think about it. And I said, okay, have a seat. I'm here. You tell me when you're ready. I have no problems. If you decide not to see me, that's okay. But if you decide to see me, I'm here. And he actually thought. He sat down and he thought for a while. And then he said, I'm ready. I did nothing to try to convince him. I did nothing. And I saw him and I treated his problem. And very soon I would find out he would come back and we'd spend half the time talking about his dead wife. That was our commonality. We talked about his dead wife. We talked about his disappointments in life. And then he would come to the clinic every week. He had a problem every week. He had a problem every week. I didn't get it at first. And then my receptionist, who is also Midwestern, said, Addie, don't you get it? You're the highlight of his week. He would come in with his Western boots, with his pants and suspenders, his hair slicked back, all 83-year-old, you know, Midwestern gentlemen. And we would sit and we would talk for hours. We would set our appointments for the end of the day. And we would talk for hours. Now, I did nothing to change myself, because he didn't need that bridge, just had this prejudice from the beginning. And I just named the elephant in the room and I said, here it is, sir, can you deal with it? But like we talked about earlier, we found a common ground. Our common ground was his dead wife. Our common ground was medicine. Our common ground were the jokes we told to each other. And we built such a relationship based on that. And I know I'm digressing away from Tokumbo's question a little bit, but I think it's related. We built such a relationship that when he unfortunately lost his first child, he told his second son, just take me to my doctor's office. I just want to see my doctor. And this is a gentleman who was racist at the room. And that has been my experience. I can't say that I haven't dealt with racism. Teaching is the way that I've dealt with it most of the time. Yes, you're absolutely right. I'm the only thing that I have the advantage because I can be myself and I can be you. I can be myself and I you in any situation. But if I don't need to be you, or if you don't allow me to build that bridge to be you, don't do it. I just bring myself the way that I am and we move on. Became, I'm not 85, I'm 83. I said, yep, you're a very handsome 83-year-old. But anyone looking at us at the end or in the place where our relationship had matured would never have guessed started from. We started from, I want to see you. I'm a fan, I'm ready to walk in. Your choice. Here I am, I'm waiting. I'm waiting. But what he came to find out, I would want to, like Wendy said, hit Nigeria and all that. And I realized that some of the conversations that we're having here is a little bit rarefied because we're talking about people who are educated. We are not even stepping outside of the realm of the educated and the corporate echelon because there is so much more out there. We talked about people, you talk about yourself, Wendy, as someone who wants to visit, someone who wants to incorporate, lived 15 years. I have three Caucasians close to me, three. And that has been dependent on the fact that they have opened the door and they have learned to know me as I am. There's so many nuances to it because Black, white, African, or it is African. Or, so when we're talking about the dominant population, that has changed over the years. It may have started with the Caucasian population, but it's now evolved to the fact that I am not pandering to white people. I'm pandering to and trying to build connections with white people, Indian people, Filipino people, Hispanics, Russians, everybody all over. But the important thing is, I believe that we should, as foreigners, as Black people, learn about ourselves, learn to know ourselves, and then we know when to stay where we are or when to move so that we can win another. Sometimes we have to move to win another, but sometimes we have to stay right where we are to win another. And that's where I'm going to end. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you. That was a, I think lots of thoughts. I like those stories as well, especially how we can have a different way to look at the same context, right? Certainly the experience you had with this older gentleman was him. And not necessarily you having to change how you thought. And he was able to do that perhaps because of what he saw in you and understanding the value that he could get out of that relationship. I've got a couple other questions here from the audience, Michael. And it says, why is culture important? A big question. I mean, I'm not quite sure what's all behind it, but the question was just why is culture important? And given your expertise in that realm, maybe you can share some thoughts with all of us on that question.
thank you for, and I learned a lot from what Ms. Adipero shared. Culture is a people's system of reality. Is a way of making sense of the world. Is a way of making sense of yourself. as long as you are, you feel a sense of importance, then what makes you use, what makes you you is equally very significant to think about. Depending on the culture, you would want to categorize and do all of that, but culture will remain significant as long as we humans continue to see ourselves the most in the most natural way. By natural, the word natural again, but this is what I mean. It is just pure fact that the system of classification and organization is based on uniqueness. Uniqueness is a way of saying different. So more than similarities, we are grouped by difference. And that is actually where we can begin to have a conversation. Our worldview, the food we eat, the cloth we wear, all of those are just a strand of our surface expression of culture. But these items of culture are, they are undergirded by certain values. And these values, they are the wellspring of what we can identify as tangible culture.
That's part of your Zoom. That's what you're
saying. It is very, It is important to understand this idea of culture as more like an iceberg. The one you see is not measurable by the one you don't see. It's deeper than what we see. And so we can reach to that core, sub-surface level of culture to begin to understand what it is that makes us who we are. You can draw a psychographic chart by looking at their daily choices, their physical appearances. My value of body would influence my choice of dress, the food that I eat. So I'm not just clothing myself, I'm nourishing my body as well. But we will continue to have these ways of thinking about culture as a other significant in and of themselves, because they continue on how we live, where we, our aspirations. And these are the things that make us who we are. We can talk about commonalities, but the uniqueness is very important, and part of every thing that has happened in the world and every terrible thing that has happened to humankind. In that way, culture is very significant to talk about, to think about.
Thanks, Ian, for sharing that. A little over halfway of the time that we want to spend together, we could maybe take one more question, and then we'll move on to the next section of our conversation. This question that came in, invented race and why? And how do we think people of color engage with issues of the, so if you can answer this one.
Part who, yeah. Who invented race and why, and what was the second part of it?
How do you think people have issues of racism?
Okay. Well, I think MAGA in that race, but no, MAGA in that race. I don't know. I think it goes back to trying its power. But when I look, and I'll take a step back as an immigration attorney, because as I listen to this, I view this in several ways. One, a woman of my age, of my religious and ethnic background, the immigration attorney whose job it is, and thank you, Ade, for that sweet shout out. I really appreciate it. I do remember now about those extra days. But the whole idea, what we do in life, we're supposed to do, or maybe I'm super naive, with all of our hearts and to find joy in what we do for a living or on a personal level. So race to me is an ugly word, not because it should be, but because it's used to create hate and divide. And I watch as an immigration attorney, and then we'll talk about current US culture. I know we're talking about throughout the world, but I'll speak specifically to what I'm seeing in my country, which is the adoptive country of many of you. But I see the fact that people are the same, but it's power. If you have, I always thought about what happened. I look at like a country, lots of countries in Africa where everybody is the same color. Everybody or the majority are the same religion. But then people create power and anger and hatred and death because of tribes, because of dialect. I've done so many asylum cases. When I first started out, when I started working in 1980, I did lots of Ethiopian asylum applications before Eritrea was separate. And I would just see things where I kind of looked at everybody and I said, everybody's the same. What are we fighting about? If we're all the same color, if we're all the same religion, if we're all this, why are we fighting? And I said, well, what if we just took everybody? And everybody just intertwined and had children together. So everybody had maybe brown skin and blue eyes or something. And everybody was the same religion and everybody was the same tribe. And I said, you know what? It really wouldn't make a difference because there would be something to fight about. And that is not Michael that you were talking to. To go and say, if we looked like a brown paper bag, because nobody looks as white as a piece of paper, and nobody looks as brown as different colors. Race is really just a way to divide. And then there was a second part to that question, and I've forgotten it. So ask me that second one, and then I'm going to answer it. Did anybody remember the second part?
Yes, this second part, and how this is in the United States.
Right. What I see, and we'll talk about Nigeria because so many of those on the call are Nigerian. Everybody comes in from a different country with a different perspective. You carry with you all of your life experiences, your socioeconomic, your educational. And when I see my Nigerian clients come in here, for the most part, there are commonalities, regardless of education. One is family. the sheer importance of family. The fact that I learned from my Nigerian clients and my Ethiopian clients, when you talk about a cousin, that doesn't necessarily mean they're related. When you talk about a brother, that doesn't necessarily mean blood relationship. That just means an embracing and inviting in an idea that you were in this together. And obviously not everybody, but for the most part, most of my clients from Nigeria who come here come with this idea that they come from a culture where everybody looks the same on the surface, and it's who you are inside, and patient, or your zest for life or your ambition that differentiates you. And now you come into America, and this is painful to me as a minority, not as minority as if I were Black, female, and from another country. But when I see people treated, if going back to the video, because everything's kind of circular, going back to the video, I think Ade, you said this, or Michael, you might've said it, one of you, what would have happened, you know, in America today, in the charged America, if this singer had not found, had not asked to be invited in? Would there have been a phone call, like at the park in New York with that crazy woman who said a Black male was attacking her when he just asked her to leash the dog? So I see all of this. And when you're coming from a country where you're not being discriminated against because skin for other reasons, and now you, where you're much educated out of this very same people, Ade, like your patient finally learned to for you and to see into your heart, and you've probably changed, I'm sure you changed that man forever because you taught him, look not at color, not at race, not at gender, but to look into the heart because you got to his heart. It's painful to see why we can't do that, why we won't look at each other, and why we won't. From a culture that is warm and loving and embracing and ambitious. And why are you looking at me like I'm going to rob you? One of my girlfriends was born in Peru. She's an attorney. She lives in Massachusetts now. And years ago, we were both living in the suburbs together. Her husband was Black, born in the South. He had his MBA from Harvard. Brilliant, nicest guy in the world. Well, and their kids were really good kids. And the husband ran a stop sign one day in the suburbs. And there was a school bus. He didn't hit anybody, or he forgot to stop. He didn't see the sign out. He was so terrified. This is going back 10 years ago, that something would happen to him in the Philadelphia suburbs, if he went to court. Mind you, his wife is an attorney, he has an MBA, they have money, they're socioeconomically fine. If he went to court alone because he was Black. And this was probably about maybe 10 or 15 years ago, and it really taught me to wear a different, her husband, this was like, nothing would happen, but his fear of growing up Black in the South as a male. This is before George Floyd. This has been the underbelly of this whole idea of race to propel people, political parties, or individuals into power. And he shouldn't have had to feel that way. And this is diverging a little, but that was the first time that I learned what the talk was between a Black father to a Black child, a male, the talk. And I was horrified that Mike and her husband would do this. Forward to what has transpired over the last couple of that belly of because of the word race using race, but it's fear. I go back, and if all of us can do what Ade did and get to one of those who hate because of difference and teach them that hate and turn it into love. And since this is reimagined, that's my utopia of just having us accepted for who we are and not looking at whether we're fat, skinny, color-wise, gender. That to me would be the most beautiful utopia. But I'm sure there would be something else to fight about. And then I just want to say one other thing along that line. And I shared this with Ariolo. My daughter went to the University of Michigan. She grew up in Philadelphia, but she grew up in a multicultural household. Both my learned Spanish as my second first language. And I thought it was important for my children to be able to move from culture to culture. And both of my children lived overseas, like you. My son did a Fulbright in Chile. So when my daughter was an undergraduate at University of Michigan, because she was used to growing up in a crazy household, in fact, wrote her college about something, and she said she grew up in a circus. And that was basically my household, because it was just people in and out, fun and drama and all that. It was such a big school, and nobody was inviting them in. She created like a club. Because they were all students, and then vegan and vegetarian. And she started asking her questions about American culture, things didn't feel comfortable asking anybody else because nobody was reaching out to them. The school might have, if you look at schools and where, if you've all gone to undergraduate here, graduate, what have foreign students hang out with the foreign students? How many of you as a foreign student got invited to an American's household for a holiday? So if we're going to change this, we invite people into our homes, maybe not physically, but we try to teach them the lesson that Ade taught her old, probably MAGA hat-bearing guy. But you might have gotten him to vote Democrat this time, Ade, if he's still alive. You just never know. But that's how, so how do we want to start with race and wind up here? There has to be an erasure. There are going to be races. We look in a mirror. There are different races, but there has to be an erasure of race as a way for not liking somebody. And we've got a lot of like.
Right. Well, thank you, Wendy. That was a lot. Something you could tell that you're pulling from personal aims there. There have been some comments in the chat. Thank you those for sharing. I see some references to in the chat that I'll encourage you to take a look at, including material that you may want to go read yourself to get a sense for where race was invented, etc. Now we have a couple of people who have raised their hands, and would afford these two individuals, we've got Tukumbo and Wale Paladay here, to share some thoughts, and then we'll move on to the next section of the session for today. So Tukumbo, I know you typed a bunch of things already, and you probably have something to share, so the floor to you.
Hi, thank you. I'm laughing because
like
it's true.
We'd like to see your face. We'd like face.
I'm not in the position to do that right now, but I definitely want to talk and hear my voice instead.
I'll make do with your voice.
Thank you very much. I appreciate thank you for that. So actually, Dr. Pia, actually, I just kind of wanted to circle back to my original. I do appreciate your response, you know, kind of sharing your experience and how you know, with the whole code switching thing. I do want to make a comment. I don't know if it's more of a question, but maybe it's a mix of a question and a comment. So code switching and in general, how it's being used and when we discuss it and how it's been used in our everyday lives. A very, very common example would be in the use of language and tone, right? So for instance, I can speak like this. I can decide that I want to switch to Naija, and I might decide, you know what? Now I'm about to say, you know, that I'm a top Black American, because there's those different things that we do in general. I guess my question really is, and my comment really is, African Americans code switch all the time. It's not just coming from people like, you know, immigrant populations or whatever. And it's the most common thing, or the most common form is in language when we intentionally make a conscious decision to speak more like, quote unquote, like mainstream white America, because we want to make everyone more. And my question really, I do want to say that, you know, it's to code switch and to kind of move the spectrum to relate. Doesn't it become unhealthy? Because we're doing, but you know, I don't always want to constantly have to worry about being myself and then being some. We get to that threshold where we don't have to constantly do that. It feels more like a like this burden that's in order to fit into mainstream America. So they feel more. When I go, or when I work with my white friends, or when I go in, so I'm not expecting, nor am I going in with the expectation that the people at work are going to code switch and kind of change and talk more like I would talk. You know what I mean? They're not going to work with that expectation. They're not going to bother trying to talk like if I was African American to make me feel better. But I am the one that is in that position where I go in thinking now I have to talk like everybody, you know, like just to make everybody feel comfortable, because, you know, if they hear this accent, they're going to be like, oh my God, no, you know, she's, I can't relate to her, which has happened on many occasions. So again, I guess what I'm trying to say is it's not as simple. Sometimes we try to simplify it, but it really isn't. And we need to ask ourselves as a community, as people of color, the question, is that, first of all, is that healthy? Number one. Secondly, is this something we want to continue to pass down from generation to generation? And what can we do as a state to alleviate that necessity constantly code switch in order to make the demographic? And just to wrap it up, it's switch, but learning is a two-way thing. Okay for me to make somebody feel comfortable by trying to speak more their kind of tone and their language, but it should also not be just one-sided. And I feel like many, it's unevenly distributed and more one-sided as opposed to a two-sided conversation that would appeal to all. That's about all my commentary and my questions about that.
Thanks for that question, because I think that really other ones. That's one.